So without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Professor Fergus Shanahan. I'm so delighted he's here with us today. He's come all the way from Cork, very special place. And it's the capital of the south of Ireland for the visitor. Where he works at UCC and at the UCC Microbiome Institute. And many people in the room will be aware that there's been lots and lots of interesting research coming out of that institute looking at the mind-body connection. And Professor Shanahan is very widely published in that area, but he's also widely published in Medical Humanities, and in 2000 has written an award-winning essay called Waiting. And in 2013, Science Foundation Ireland named him Researcher of the Year. So I'm really delighted to welcome you here today. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Elizabeth and Melissa, for inviting us here. This is not my normal habitat. I don't normally get invited to meetings like this, so it's a real novelty and privilege for me. In fact, I have a colleague who, if he heard, and if he does hear, that I'm actually speaking at a meeting like this, he will almost certainly award me an academic yellow card. And in sport, you know what a yellow card is. It's a warning. You're only one away from a red card. And in academia, that's retirement or emeritus status. And emeritus means, well, the E means out of it. And emeritus means deservedly so. You get the academic yellow card if you're caught at a symposium where you're asked to chair a session but not contribute to the session, or asked to contribute the introduction to an anthology of chapters on some topic, but not actually to contribute a chapter on that topic, or if you're ever caught saying, in my experience, or perhaps if you're speaking on some lofty topic like this, in my rarefied scientific atmosphere, this would get you probably a straight red, maybe. But I'm not a literary scholar. I am a doctor, and my only credentials here really are that I have actually read the material that I'll reference and mention, and it has certainly enriched me. And my first occasion when I ventured into what I call the medical humanities, or if you like, mining literature for medicine, was in an article where we mined James Joyce. You mentioned I'm from Cork, but I actually only work in Cork, I'm a dog. So I went to James Joyce to look for medicine and literature. It wasn't the first, of course, but we submitted an article to an American journal, and I mentioned it later. It's a fairly prestigious journal, Perspectives in Biology and Medicine, and a lot of the editorial board are Nobel Prize winners. And I think the editor liked what we wrote, and normally you get, in science anyway, you get two reviewers who advise the editor if this is acceptable, if there's anything flawed or wrong with it. Occasionally you get a third reviewer if you're controversial, if there's a disparity in the two reviews. Rarely you get a fourth reviewer if there's something really contentious. Never will you get a fifth reviewer, and we had six reviewers. So I've kept them all these years, and it was clear that because it was on mining medicine from literature, it was Joycean, they went obviously to a lot of literary scholars, including certain well-known professors of English in universities not too far from here. And the general attitude was, who do these guys think they are? And I've experienced this kind of attitude when I've been to the common room in University College Cork, where not much happens. It's a place where mainstream academics hang out and talk about nothing, as far as I could see. And I occasionally go in for refreshment. But they would come up and say, you know, we would never think of going out to your hospital and telling you something about medicine. But you don't seem to have any problem coming down here to us and talking to us about literature. So I'm sensitive to that point, but I'm no literary scholar, but I do know how to take things from literature, and it has certainly enriched me. And the whole meeting has enriched me. I've enjoyed hugely just listening to those voices, and Jim Lucy earlier today, and the session on poetry. It was just a calming effect, straight off. So I've loved it. Does anyone know what this word means. Now, it actually kind of looks like something where you feel like you're really decrepit, you know. And I twisted my ankle yesterday, and I am feeling a bit ultra-crepidarian. But the picture on the right are these very clever young men in Cork who paint and draw words. And this is their interpretation. So that should help you to figure out what ultra-crepidarian actually is. And in this audience, I'm feeling a bit that way. And ultra-crepidarian means that. So the response we had to those six reviewers is sort of said, well, who do these guys think they are? This guy should have talked about this topic. And they looked at my, well, they may have looked up what I do and thought, well, what does he know about this? And we only had to make one change to the article to satisfy the editor. We just said, this is by non-Joyceans, for non-Joyceans. And that was enough. And so that's the attitude with which I bring to Solaria. I do know this much. I do know, and it took me some time to be able to express it as well as this is a title of an article. And Robert Brooke was a professor at UCLA where I spent 10 years. And I think he said it better than anyone else. A physician, the formula is emotion plus passion plus science. I think all of those are ingredients to be a physician. Incidentally, I don't distinguish between psychiatry, disorders of the mind, mental illness, and mainstream medicine. As far as I'm concerned, they're all the same. It's all part of one thing. I don't see why mental health or psychiatry shouldn't be just a branch of medicine. I don't think it has to be some separate thing way off, separated from it. So when I speak about a physician, I include obviously psychiatrists, although physician sometimes is regarded as somewhat outside the field of mental health and psychiatry. I certainly got science from my training, and I do fancy myself as a clinician scientist. I have lots of passion, I got that from my mother. But to get the emotional part of what we do is not something that I learned anywhere in my training, and not something I feel I can convey to my students. And that had to come from somewhere else. So some time ago, I was asked to write an article by this is actually a journal from the Royal College of Physicians in the UK. And they were addressing this topic about physician burnout, which is a popular topic today. It's not just restricted to physicians. It could be nurse burnout or any kind of burnout, really professional burnout. Now, many of the people I hear about that have burned out actually, in my view, never ignited in the first place. So it's no surprise to me that they're a bit burnt out. But in the course of doing this, I concluded that, again, with minimal data, because it's hard to find data on this, and I can't use the expression in my experience, because that would get another yellow card, which would be out. But from my reading and interviews and talking to people, I concluded that those people who lose their way didn't first of all have a scientific way of thinking. And medicine is a science. It's also an art, but it's the science of the art. They lost their way because they don't adhere to a scientific way of thinking and dealing with patients. They also lost their way because they weren't able to tackle illness as well as disease. Disease is that objective thing we see, but illness is the experience of that disease. And I think the only place you get that is actually from the humanities. You can get that from personal experience to some degree, but we're only one person. You can get much more of it if you can broaden your experience by probing the literature. So I ended up changing the title of this for the editor, and I put that in, Who Needs Doctors? Because those who don't practice the scientific way of thinking and those who don't embrace the humanities in its broadest context, including literature, in my view, can't actually maintain a relationship and a feeling for the ordinary. And I think the ordinary is really quite remarkable. I'm still intrigued by simple clinical science and ordinary stories. And the thing that makes me feel privileged every day is that I'm allowed to be part of a patient's story. I'm also a patient myself, and I've had a son who's had a serious illness. I've had to play father and doctor to him. But I'm generally privileged to be part of patient stories. And the great writers are great storytellers, and as physicians and clinicians and nurses and other caregivers, we're all part of stories. And that's justifies me probing literature to look at other stories, and I have that in common with great writers. So we do live in changing times, of course we do, but isn't it interesting that this editor from The Lancet, it's quite a while ago now, but he was writing about predicting what will happen in the future, and you should never do that, of course. You can only predict what should change, not what will happen. But he said, predicting medicine's future is to enter into a hive of competing possibilities. Super specialization, molecular medicine, technical advances in diagnosis and treatment, evidence-based everything. But the most radical change is likely to be in the doctor-patient relationship. And I was chatting with one of your colleagues here this morning, we were commenting about how many people are not self-aware and don't even think about what they're doing in their daily life. They don't stand back. And those who are involved in the doctor-patient relationship on the left-hand side of that, the doctor, or be it a nurse or a caregiver, frequently we just run through by rote. It's almost like we're in a Beckett play or something. Everything's meaningless. We're just wandering along, going to work and off work. But we don't stand back and actually think about what's actually happening. And there's loads of room for good science and investigation in that. And is it any surprise then, written around the same year, that the doyen of the history of medicine, Roy Porter, the late Roy Porter, wrote this in this fabulous book on the history of medicine, we're healthier than ever. Medical achievements never greater, but it's a paradox. Rarely has medicine drawn such intense doubt and disapproval. We've had more time to worry and be concerned about our health than ever before. And yet, we have all these advances happening. We're living longer and healthier in general than in previous eras, but we're more concerned about that. How can that be? Doctors making such great advances and yet we have more suspicion about them than ever before. And there's another paradox. Caregiving. Now, you know, we don't cure much in medicine. We care for things, we control things. But yet, we don't need much investment. I was interested, there is a program in UCD in the medical school there, and you have some here who will be speaking on that. But we actually, in general, give little investment when we're making a doctor or a nurse. We don't give a huge amount of investment in the things that count, caregiving. Yet, any one of us would say, but of course that's hugely important. But yet, we don't invest that much in it. And I think that is a paradox, maybe one of the reasons why that comment was made about predicting the future. So here's the hub of it all. I'm a clinician scientist. I have written lots of textbooks on disease. I've trained here at Dublin. Nothing in my training ever told me much about illness. It told me an awful lot about disease, which is very variable. And I look at the black and the white and the grey of disease, and that creates all this variation. And I look at the genetics of the diseases. But I'm all the time looking at the objective measurements of disease. But nothing has ever prepared me, or any doctor I know of, or trained any of them, or I don't see any of it in our textbooks, about illness, which is, of course, coloured, not black and white or grey, nuanced, individual, completely personal. And yes, I know something about it because I have been ill myself and I have had my family be ill, and I mentioned my son with a serious illness. And I see patients who tell me about it, but that has its limitations. But that's the only real sources of ways in which I can educate myself about illness, which is the experience that the patients go through. And these words don't feature in any of the textbooks that I've written, or any of the textbooks that I was trained on, or indeed any of the medical curriculum that we instruct our students today. These are these illness words that the patients know all about, but curiously, I'm not sure many of the doctors really think that much about. And I want to pause and just mention my colleague Seamus O'Mahony, because under my encouragement, actually, he railed against this tokenism at times to narrative medicine, and he was really railing against people like Rita Sharon and certain people who feel that we must jettison in some tokenism to do with the medical humanities, whether it be art appreciation, literature appreciation, poetry appreciation, whatever you have, as some way in which we're going to improve doctors by doing that. And his point is that if you have that utilitarian view of narrative medicine or the medical humanities, you'll be disappointed. You might be wasting students' time. And his argument was, and I think it's worthy of reading that article, that's why I put it up, because there is an opposing view. But his conclusion is that the reason to study literature or other aspects of the humanities is that it gives us a rich hinterland and perspective. And by hinterland, he means a connection with broader culture, a connection with the world beyond the medical school and the hospital, and a perspective of understanding our place in medicine, in society, and the historic forces that shaped us and where we might be going, challenges in the future. How many doctors do you think actually think about that on a day-to-day basis? We'd be less Beckettian if we probably just stood back and thought a bit about what we're doing. And I think the medical humanities and literature in general can do that for you. So now what I want to do is just tell you about, I can't say in my experience, so therefore I have to say how mining literature has helped me. So this will be personal. It's purely a perspective. It doesn't claim to be right or wrong, but I'm going to take you to very few examples of understanding what it feels like to be ill, because that's what I get from it. I just told you, I can only know something about what it feels like to be ill based on my own individual experience as a patient, or my family being patients, or listening to some of my patients. But that is limited. Literature gives me a broader feeling for that. I'm going to talk about how it can give you context, one example that's relevant to us today in Ireland. A couple of quick examples about mining literature for fun to do pathobiography, and I'm going to reconstruct Charles Darwin, who was probably the greatest scientist, at least in the life sciences that ever existed, and the greatest idea ever. And I'm going to give you a diagnosis for him. And how literature can help communication. And lastly, that great thing about how to behave with the ill. Because it was only when I had serious illness with my son that came close to us, I discovered the awkwardness that friends have toward me. And when that his diagnosis was made known, how people started to avoid me. And contrived reasons not to see me. And even gave reasons that claimed that I had said I wanted to be left alone. In other words, what they were really doing was contriving up a reason to avoid me, claiming that I had said something like this, when in actual fact, the only thing I wanted was them to be there and to care. So, I won't dwell too long on that because I've heard better examples this morning, and you all have your own examples, and just one or two. But first again say how to listen is clearly important because we start with hearing it from our patients. And that's actually a drawing I asked a patient actually to draw for me, to be used in a different context. And in fact, I was portraying something that often referred to as la maladie de petit papier. The patient comes in as their symptoms all written down on a piece of paper. And you'd love to say, well, if they're that important, why did you need to write them down? But never say something like that. But isn't it interesting the way he drew it? No prompting for me. And he didn't know this, but that is showing how the barrier between the doctor and the patient. For the guy on the left, it's actually routine. He's relaxed. He's heard it all before. He doesn't have to look like that. That's a surgeon, by the way. A physician would never do that. He'd never sit like that. That's clearly a surgeon. You can see probably an ophthalmologist into the bar. I never had to do any night call or anything like that. But it's crisis for the person on the right-hand side of the drawing. And that alone is a barrier. The second thing about this is that we don't see patients at their best. We actually see them at their worst, at their most vulnerable. We often see them prostrate in the bed in pajamas, and we're wearing sometimes three-piece suits and neckties. So if there wasn't, that wasn't one-upmanship, what is? They are at their most vulnerable, and they're in the worst possible situation to shine. And we're expecting them to give us the whole story. So listening, as someone said today, is all about looking at body language and sometimes saying nothing at all. as opposed to what Miriam McCallan does on TV, where she actually interviews people and waits to speak as opposed to listening. So occasionally, but not often, have patients said remarkable things to me that actually stunned me. And I was the last of a whole series of third, fourth, fifth opinions for someone who was being referred for surgery. And this man was to have a colectomy for a very serious illness. And he arrived in, and he clearly couldn't read or write, and he couldn't really express himself very well, so the whole family came in with him, and they did the talking. And this went on for ages, and it all seemed fairly routine. It all seemed like, yeah, this, he should have a colectomy, he should have a stoma. Until he said this in very halting. It took him at least 5 minutes to get this out, and I mean 5 minutes to get this out. In pausing language, he said, I know that if I had the surgery, it would be easier, pause, for the doctors and nurses. And by that he meant his family, who were impatient with him, because they had to clean up for after him. But it wouldn't be easier for me. Now, had I not listened to that, he was definitely going to get a curt note, and I would say, yeah, everything I agree. I agree that she was surgery. Instead, we made a bigger effort then to help him and get on top of this. And while we didn't cure him and we didn't get great control over it, we did better for him than just moving him along and letting him go to the guy on the left. Occasionally, a woman has said to me, when an issue about reversal of a stoma, such as this woman who came with her husband, and the husband was happy enough with their marriage and didn't really want her to change the stoma because he saw how ill she was before. It's a patient with Crohn's disease. And when you reconnect them, it can have adverse consequences in terms of reactivation of disease. And he did most of the talking again until she said, but, you know, I just feel like a big stoma. And her whole body image is one of a big stoma. And it was words like that that convinced me that, no, we'll reconstruct this lady. Or occasionally, this is the only time someone has this, has said, I went through a situation where patients occasionally acquire a label of chronic disease. And if you've got a disease that's chronic relapsing and remitting, it can be very difficult to remove that label. So this was a young man who had acquired a label of Crohn's disease, but any time I investigated him, I couldn't actually find any evidence for Crohn's disease. But still, he was invalided with it, and it just went on and on and on and on. And I eventually got all the records out from all the other clinicians he'd seen. The doctor hopped all around the place and got out all the x-rays and everything else. And I was then ready to remove the word Crohn's disease from the entire chart and release him, free him up, liberate him, get rid of all this nonsense. Because it would be better for him from the point of view of getting a mortgage, insurance, things like that, because they load your premium if you've got a pre-existing illness like that. Until he said, you're not going to take away my illness, are you? And in a moment of incredible honesty, he actually told me that's all he ever had. And he needed it as a crutch. So he just stays with me, a bit like an albatross, I suppose, and we just never really talk much about the Crohn's disease. We do talk about what he's complaining about, and we just never address that ever again. And I'm not sure how you tackle that, but he's the only one who gave me that kind of insight, but it wouldn't have emerged. I see him differently now because I bothered to listen to him on that day. So one other example, so that's what you can get. I mean, that's limited. And I don't think I don't have a huge repository of stories like that. So I have to search and get it from other sources. And I'm going to give you one because of the nature of this symposium today. But if I were ever asked to explain to anyone what bipolar disease is like, or even the side effects of lithium. And occasionally I feel I'm on a high myself because I'm most creative when I'm revved up and have loads of coffee on board. So I do know how addictive the highs of bipolar disease can be, and I've worked with some bipolar people. But if anyone ever really wanted to know about what it's like, you wouldn't go to the textbooks. You'd get some of the facts there, but you wouldn't really get the truth of it all. And that's Kay Redfield Jameson. So many of you would know about her, but this is her in Cork when she came years ago to speak on a symposium entitled Experience of Illness, Learning from the Arts. And that book, in my view, is an absolute classic. It's been out since about 1995. I tell all the medical students, don't even listen to the lectures. This is what you need to read. And there are several examples of that in other areas, and you will all know more. They don't have to be big, full books. They could be poems. They could be little snippets. And this is one little snippet, if you like, that I don't think I'd ever thought about had I not spotted this. This is the Ruth Picardy. She was a journalist working for The Observer, I think. And she developed breast cancer, and the idea was that she would write a diary and they would publish her experience of this illness as she'd go through the whole process. Now, she died before she really was able to get much of a body of material together. But she did get some together, and it was published in this slim volume Before I Say Goodbye. But I don't think I've ever heard it expressed as well, but it might have been like for her husband. Now, it can be hard for clinicians and maybe for women at times to always be thinking about the husband when the wife has the disease, and it's hard to muster up much sympathy. But whatever the husband is feeling obviously does get transmitted to the wife, and they in fact did undergo a distancing and a separation during all that time. And this is what he said. If I close my eyes and travel in time, I can still feel the delicious weight of Ruth's left breast in my right hand. Eros and, as it turned out, Thanatos, gorgeously cupped in my palm. That was before we knew about her cancer. Once we knew, I found it unbearable to touch her there. She never seemed to blame my squeamishness, but in retrospect, the lump not only grew within her, but between us, spreading as inexorably as the cancer itself. So I've shown that to some of the medical students and the surgeons to just think about the whole picture, and I don't think many of them would spend enough time with a couple going through this and get that feeling. So that is another reason why one minds literature and illness memoirs. But it can be fiction, it doesn't have to be non-fiction, of course. And occasionally there's game. This is an article we wrote some time ago, again for that journal of the Royal College of Physicians. And some people have been well able to express gain. I'll just give lots of examples here. But illness isn't always about loss. There can be gain. And I alert you to the last one on there on the right, my dyslexia. And that is actually written by a poet, Pulitzer Prize-winning poet, whose difficulty in childhood and the delayed diagnosis of dyslexia gave him a fondness and a feeling for words and the power of words that he struggled with greatly because of his dyslexia, but enabled him eventually to become an award-winning poet. So illness isn't always about loss. There's loss, of course, but there can be gain as well. Now I want to give you context and quickly go through some of these things. So obviously mainly I mine literature to get a feeling for illness, which I don't get in my scientific world, but context also. And think about Ireland, think about Dublin. I grew up in the 50s and 60s. And any picture of Dublin in the 50s and 60s, I'll go back before it. And one thing you see is lots of children, and lots of poverty, and frequently religious walking by on the footpaths, nurses and clerics. That's what a lot of the photographs that one sees. And then we expressed shock, horror, and amazement, and I think hypocrisy, when we read of the Murphy Report, the Ferns Report, the Ryan Report, and God knows how many reports we read about child abuse in our religious institutions. And we're having that revisited again now in relation to what's going on in Fiume. Our variants of it are being dredged up. And I wondered, well, did we not really always really know this? Didn't we know about our attitudes to children in Ireland? And I certainly felt when I came back from the United States that attitudes to children here weren't as rosy as I thought, as people would like to portray. Even in restaurants, children weren't tolerated as well as they are in restaurants in America. And I never felt there was any great warmth or fond attitudes towards children in any respect in the Ireland that I grew up in. And always thought I knew about abuse in institutions. I didn't have to be told about Magdalene Audrey's. I knew where there was, and I knew what went on, I think. And I heard nuances, little snippets overhear my parents and other people speak, unfinished sentences. And And my colleague and I decided to go back and look at this. We decided to mine literature. Where else would you go but Joyce? Now, if you want just one guide for me, I would say always go to the great writers. Proust, Joyce, any of the great writers. Now, Proust, you'll get the experience of illness personally, his own asthma and his neurosis. Joyce will give you public health, childhood illnesses, but mainly public health problems, infectious diseases, social illnesses. And that was the article where we got the 6 reviews, by the way. But Joyce would give you images in language of Dublin. And if you go back to the photographs, you'll see it's telling the truth. This is one from 1904, actually, and you can see lots of bowler hats, but the children are in bare feet. The adults are not in bare feet. And this is widely available in you can get all these pictures readily available in any of the galleries. So we decided today to do one thing. We'd take a single collection of Joyce's short stories published in 1914, but written during an earlier time. Remember the difficulty getting it published, and remember the difficulties he had with censorship. So he wasn't at liberty to speak clearly and to write clearly. So he wrote in very subtle ways with a scrupulous meanness of his text. And we wrote this article for History Ireland at the time of one of those reports that we were notionally scandalized by or shocked by, and should have known better, and in my view were expressing hypocrisy. We just asked the question, do we not already know all this? So Joyce said at the time of Dubliners, that collection of 15 short stories, that you can go back and back again and again, and you can mine lots of things, not just medicine from it, but there's certainly lots of medicine in it. My intention was to write the moral history of Dublin, to give Dubliners a looking glass, one good look at themselves. So that wasn't a bad start to ask the question, despite all the constraints of censorship. Straight off, in the first few chapters, they're about youth, children, but in almost all the chapters, children are mentioned, and frequently with unusual relationships with the clergy that aren't quite wholesome. This one of the opening chapters, the sisters, where old Cotter comes into the house, something has happened. The old failed priest is ill now, and probably has had a stroke, and died, or is dying, and old Cotter, this wise old codger, comes in, representing the rest of Dubliners. Now, I wouldn't say he was exactly, but there was something queer. There was something uncanny about him. I'll tell you my opinion, unfinished sentences. In other words, damning him, really. Lots of innuendo, without actually saying anything. Joyce being incredibly clever to get this past the censors, but saying something at the same time. And yet, exactly the way Dubliners would have gone on. I think it was one of those peculiar cases. But it's hard to say. And then it becomes a bit more explicit. I wouldn't like children of mine to have much to say to a man like that. But Joyce is actually very fair with the clergy. And in the later story, in Grace, Martin Cunningham says, you get some bad ones and you get some good ones. Because bear in mind, clergy, they all came from Irish society. They all had parents. Some of those were abused. Many of those went into those orders at a young age. They reflect Irish society. They are something different that we almost all be hypocritical about now. They are us. And Joyce shows that, actually, in the other stories and in some of these, the same ones. This is from an encounter. 2 young boys commenting on Dublin, not understanding what they're seeing, but actually encountering a queer old josser. He began to speak on the subject of chastising boys. They ought to be whipped and whipped. My heart was beating quickly for fear that he would seize me. Or in Old Jack in Ivy Day in the Common Room. It's hard to know what way to bring up children. Only I'm an old man now, I take a stick to his back. He's referring to his younger son. He's wondering why his younger son isn't a bit more like him. And beat him while I could stand over him, as I've done many a time before. And he's wondering why his son is misbehaving, when that is actually his attitude to children. Or in Evelyn, where she's planning to emigrate, and she's staring wistfully down out the window, and planning to emigrate to a less than savoury place and possibly into a life of prostitution if she does it. Her head was leaned against the window curtains. Father used to hunt them in, she's remembering childhood. She's 19 at the time, with his blackthorn stick. Her mother was dead now. Now she was going away like the others. Though she was over 19, she sometimes felt herself in danger of her father's violence. And she manifests palpitations and even nausea when she's thinking about the violence in the home. And the only reason she doesn't go, or we're left to believe she doesn't go, is because she's fearful for the younger ones who'd suffer at his hand. And lastly, who couldn't be moved by this portrayal of parental alcoholism and neglect and violence in a home in Joyce's counterparts in that same slim volume of Dubliners? When this little child is left alone while the father is out drinking and the mother's gone to the sodality at church praying for some solace. And he comes home and the little child says, "Oh, Pa, don't beat me, and I'll say Hail Mary for you." Who couldn't be moved by that? So, has much changed since Joyce writing 100 years ago? You only have to look at more modern contemporary writers, Ronnie Doyle, Frank McCourt, Patrick McCabe, John McGarren. Probe John McGarren, and you'll certainly see the attitudes to children in our society. And we wonder now about the religious, what they did. They were a manifestation of Irish society. Autobiography, Reconstructing Darrell. I'll quickly go through this because it was just a little vignette. But if anyone has irritable bowel syndrome here in the audience, let me tell you, you're not alone. This is probably my greatest hero. This is Darwin, the greatest scientist probably ever, certainly in the life sciences. And his story is one of celebrity illness. There's probably no one else was written about more because of their illness than Darwin. Now, there have been Florence Nightingale, various people have been written about by chronic illness, but Darwin has appeared an awful lot. And there are oodles and oodles of articles about him. And the articles fall into two groups. One claiming that, well, really he was a bit neurotic and depressed and he had a mental illness. And most of the champions and people who are champions of evolution don't like that really, because they'd rather their hero to have some undiagnosed illness that maybe a poisoning or something, and he'd appear an old man like a virile. I reconstructed that because all of the information is in his own writing. And if you ever want a description of the full manifestations of functional bowel disease, they're there. And Darwinian dyspepsia was not some rare condition. It was just an ordinary, an extraordinary scientist with an ordinary illness, born with great dignity. And I won't say any more than that, but it gave me great joy to mine literature, his own writings, to actually come up with a diagnosis, and I challenge anyone to dispute me. Communication. I know I'm going to get a warning in a minute about time, but I'm watching time. I started a bit late, so I'm going to take every minute I can. Communication. The eponym. I mean, just simple things why literature is worth mining. Medicine is full of misnomers, full of bad language. I actually do a talk and wrote an article on bad language in gastroenterology. And actually, I think a lot of the people who attended the talk I gave thought I was going to be using loads of expletives, but that's not what it was. I was just talking about how bad our language is, and we wonder about miscommunication in medicine. Because biliary colic isn't a colic. Pernicious anemia is not pernicious. Vitamin D is not a vitamin, it's a hormone. And various other examples here that I've listed. And it goes on and on. There are only ones in my arena. There are many, many more that you have to explain to people. Well, I know you're saying that, but it doesn't really mean that. And we get to say, even look at the words we use, like idiopathic. What in arts do we use the word idiopathic? What word is that? Or etiology. Yeah. I mean, if we knew the cause of a disease, we'd say, the cause of that is that. But when you don't know the cause, you say, the etiology of that is not unknown. What on earth for the word is etiology? Why can't we use just simple things? I don't know what's happening. I feel like I've got some EEG here. I'm actually being studied with this thing about it. Even Molly Bloom from Ulysses said it when she went to see the gynecologist in his posh rooms in Fitzwilliam Square. Where do those old fellows get all the words they have? I wouldn't trust them too far. And she's commenting, first of all, about the gilt mirrors and the carpets. And incidentally, he charged her, I looked it up and got the from the Bank of Ireland, got the value of today. He charged her the equivalent of an annual wage for an industrial worker in that single day. And Joyce was meticulous on costs. He had the costs of plums and costs of transfers right. I bet he got that one right too. That's what she was charged, and she didn't even know what he was talking about. So eponyms, they're frequently inaccurate. Crohn's disease. Actually, Crohn didn't describe it. In fact, there were two other people on the paper, and they're all Jews in New York, and the two families who weren't mentioned now hate Crohn's family. And the truth of the matter is, none of them really described it, because D.L. Scott described it about 50 years earlier than Crohn did. So they're inaccurate. They're also not very appealing. I don't think if I had writer's syndrome, I'd want to be named after a Nazi sympathizer. And if I had Vegetative granulomatosis, a ferociously aggressive condition of vasculitis, I don't think I'd like to have my disease named after another Nazi sympathizer. So there are other reasons why they're not attractive. I don't know if this projects right. Yes. So, but, you know, there are eponyms we have to stick with. Like, I don't think we'd want to change Hodgkin's lymphoma from non-Hodgkin's, or we wouldn't want to change from tetralogy of Fallot. It's too complex a condition. But this is one that was just clear observation by a neurologist I work with, and I confirmed it with the geriatricians. This is a complex feature that people undergo when they're delirious or close to death. And palliative care medicine people will tell you this happens. It has an awful cacophonous medical term that I won't mention. But there is a term for this where they start grabbing the sheets, and they invariably die within 24-48 hours at that time. And it's known, it's well known. Now Shakespeare described it, so did Flaubert, Tolstoy, all the great writers, and even Goya painted it. And in Shakespeare, it's in Henry V. So we decided, well, why not go with Henry V's side? Far easier to say, no one's going to take any grief from it, no one will be upset, it's not Shanahan's sign, it's just a nice literary eponym. And there are many of those that we could use as a nice way to communicate a complex sign. Okay, there are just a few simple examples. I want to finish now, in a few minutes I have, with why I think literature has been helpful on the very complex thing about how do you behave when someone's ill. And many doctors have never even thought about it. They're not even aware. So Seamus Heaney, after he had a stroke, and not that long before he actually died, but he had a stroke, as you will recall, a very mild stroke, but nonetheless a stroke that involved rehabilitation. And he was inspired. He wanted to give a gesture of gratitude to the people who just didn't seem to do much, but they were there in their silence to support. And he was inspired by a biblical miraculous healing. And he begins with, not the one who takes up his bed, and not the person giving the care or the healer, but the people who stand and wait. The ones who had known him all along. Just the people who are there to offer support, and nothing more than that. And that was the gesture to that. And Julia Darling, in her poem, How to Behave with the Ill, expresses some of the irritation, the hypersensitivity that the ill can have. So when you're sick, could become hypersensitive, acutely aware of what people say, very quickly take offense to what they might say, very quickly take offense to what a well-intentional gesture might have been. So one has to be sensitive to that, understanding of that. And she does point out, it's hard, I know, but the one thing that is consistent, not just in this poem, but in everyone's illness memoirs, don't ignore the ill. Don't find reasons. Don't contrive reasons to not go see them. Don't contrive reasons to not be there, because they do want you to be there. It is never true they don't want you to be there. They might want you to be there if you go cackle, cackle, cackle all through it and ask them, are they better since they brought you the balloons along or something like that. But people do want you to be there. And there's this change that happens when an illness is declared. When an illness is discovered or declared, the first thing people do is frequently conceal it. And they're concealing it in part because they want to protect some of their loved ones, but they're also concealing it because they know that things change. The minute that diagnosis is made known, they know that there will be a change in the relationship between themselves and their friends and their loved ones. And it's the awkwardness of the behavior of their friends that actually creates the stigma associated with illness. Stigma only occurs with illness because of the behavior of others. Stigma isn't some natural accompaniment of illness. It's the behavior of others and how they treat the ill that creates the stigma. And that adds to the loss, of course. So even Alan Bennett said that when he was diagnosed, he went in for his to a private guy in Harvey Street and had a colonoscopy. And it was such a small place, they all knew when the colon cancer was found. And he said, even when he was writing his check to pay for the colonoscopy, the receptionist, who clearly did know, she found it hard to look at him. And in turn, he felt in some way that he failed. And Robert McCrum, who was the editor of Fodor and Fodor, and who also was best known for The Story of English, some of you remember that series on TV many years ago, he had a stroke as a young man, and he also commented about a sense of shame that he had when he had a stroke because of the behavior of others, that awkwardness. The majority of passers-by simply did not see him as he was disabled, and or treat you with a mixture of disdain or pitying arrogance. So it's the behavior of others we need to consider. And do any of you recall in the King's Speech, where the uncrowned king, the prince, was asked to give a speech, and he would have been capable of doing it, but it was only when he looked at the expression on the face of the clergy, some of the other people at Wembley Stadium, and his wife, who initially looked hopeful, worried, frightened, and then embarrassed and looked away in disappointment and embarrassment, thereby amplifying the awfulness and the ordeal for him. So the ordeal is largely, many people would say, it was never the illness, it was the stigma associated with the illness that was the burden of the illness. And you'd imagine doctors and caregivers and nurses and people in this audience would be well aware of things like that and would be well aware of how to behave. So this is the remarkable story of David Raben, published over 30 years ago, and it's still as chilling as ever. And it's the same for the family. His daughter wrote the book, Six Parts Love, about how his illness with motor neuron disease, or Lou Gehrig's disease, or ALS, motor neuron disease, and how that changed the way in which their interactions with friends changed. So he was 45 years, he was the head of endocrinology, major figure in endocrinology at Vanderbilt. And he felt a sense of shame as well. He was willing to continue working, but it was just because the diagnosis became known that then he encountered isolation from fellow physicians and the way they treated him. And it's a very short piece, you don't have to read the book, but I recommend you go to the piece in the New England Journal from 30 years ago. And the most chilling piece is actually the day that he fell in the hospital, and the response was somebody he knew looked the other way, tried to pretend he didn't see, and rushed off in the other direction. I can't say it as well as he said it in the article, but it's absolutely chilling, and many people have had those kind of experiences. Christopher Hitchens, writing about the inevitable awfulness, actually puts tongue in cheek, but does talk about maybe we should have a contract or some sort of code of etiquette on how the people with the cancers interact with the caregivers and the visitors. And I highly recommend this, which is hugely humorous. I have prostate cancer. I can say it better than I could ever say it. But his point being, don't come along with petty stories. The one thing someone who's sick never wants to hear is that Mrs. Murphy down the road has a much worse illness. Or John over here. Don't tell them, don't regale them with stories of some other similar illness. That's the last thing they want to hear. And they don't want to hear about petty stories about what might help them, petty cures. That is not what they want. Now, the literature is actually full of do's and don'ts and received wisdom. And I listed some of them here. Never insincerity. Someone said today that Anthony Clare said that sincerity is the key thing. If you could fake that, you got it made. Actually, that was George Barnes who said that originally. But the sick are acutely sensitive and they'll pick up on insincerity in a second. And don't try it. Never risk that. And I don't know what to say is the honest thing to say. They don't even want you to say anything. They just want you to be there and show you care. And same with the family. As a father of a son of an advanced cancer, I know what it's like when people turn the other way and don't want to see and don't want to talk to you. And be careful about humor. There was actually a humorous touch to a poem we had this morning, which I loved, but you have to be able to pull it off. Now these two characters, Seamus Heaney, who'd had a stroke and was in recovery here in Dublin after a stroke. I think he got the stroke when he was up in Donegal. He was supposed to meet his friend over here, Brian Friel. He didn't get to meet, but eventually Brian Friel came to meet him while he was in recovery. But Brian Friel himself, a year earlier, had had a bigger stroke. And he was able to say, different stroke. But don't risk it if you're not in that kind of situation. So I'll conclude by saying what I've got from my new literature is, and on this topic about how to behave, you can support the ill in this old-fashioned way of just being there, say nothing. You don't have to say anything. And the last word to Robert McCrum, because he's so better able to say it than I could, he was indifferent towards and frightened of illness in the past, and now he recognizes it as just part of the human condition. And if you can accept that, then we'll minimize the stigma associated and the awkwardness of interacting with the ill. You just have to treat it as just accept it. So there is my contribution. Thank you very much for your time.